Good morning. If I look a little puzzled, it's because I'm still trying to figure out what happened to a video I thought we were showing. Nope? Well, no, I thought there was one before and one after. Okay, well, I've not learned in 45 years how to read an order of worship. So, life isn't always easy. Anyone who's been a Christian for very long knows that. One of the things I have the most trouble with are pastors who fill their churches in the wrong way. They promise their people that because God loves them and they love God, that every day will be a blessing, that they'll have nothing but wealth and riches, and that life will be good. I hope that none of you are under that illusion. But if you are, I don't think it's a very frank assessment of Christianity. Considering the fact that of the first 12 people that gave their lives to Christ, one committed suicide, 10 died in terrible ways, and one should have died, but didn't. That's the strange case of John, who tradition tells us was boiled in oil but survived. Kind of a Daniel in the lions type story. And through the years, the church has grown the most through times of persecution and hardship. And I think there's a reason for that. In this series, I believe that Jason is trying to get us to look at God, particularly at Jesus, in a different way. I think he's trying to encourage us to go beyond the child stories, the things we're taught in Sunday school, to see a deeper vision of Jesus as someone that we can not only relate to in life, but who can relate to the real life that we go through. Our first scripture this morning is from the Gospel according to Matthew. We're going to be reading from the 11th chapter. As John's disciples were leaving, Jesus began to speak to the crowd about John. What did you go out into the wilderness to see? A reed swayed by the wind? If not, what did you go out to see? A man dressed in fine clothes? No. Those who wear fine clothes are in kings' palaces. Then what did you go out to see? A prophet? Yes. I tell you, and more than a prophet, this is the one about whom it is written, I will send my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way before you. Truly, I tell you, among those born of women, there has not risen anyone greater than John the Baptist. Yet whoever is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven has been subjected to violence, and violent people have been raiding it. For all the prophets and the law prophesied until John. And if you are willing to accept it, he is the Elijah who was to come. Whoever has ears, let them hear. I think also I would like to read the 13th chapter of Matthew right now, beginning with verse 10. The disciples came to him and asked, "Why do you speak to the people in parables?" And he replied, "Because the knowledge of the secrets of the kingdom of heaven has been given to you, but not to them. Whoever has will be given more, and they will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what they have will be taken away. And this is why I speak to them in parables. Though seeing, they do not see. Though hearing, they do not hear or understand. In them is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah. You will be ever hearing, but never understanding. You will be ever seeing, but never perceiving. For this people's heart has become calloused. They hardly hear with their ears. They have closed their eyes." Heavenly Father, as we begin this morning, I just pray for an outpouring of your Holy Spirit. Gracious Father, you have promised that to all who ask, the Spirit will be given. And we seek your Spirit. We cannot survive as Christians without it. And our worship becomes meaningless if your Holy Spirit's not at the center of it. So guide our words, Lord, our hearts, our music as we sing and celebrate, and bring the blessing of your Holy Spirit upon us. Amen. The story of John the Baptist is a very interesting one. I mean, what person knew Jesus any better than John? We're told in the Gospels that when Jesus' mother came to visit John's mother, that John leaped in the womb. I mean, even before he was born, John knew who Jesus was. His whole life, his whole ministry had been dedicated to preparing for the time when Jesus would begin his ministry. So you would think if there was any man who had it all together, it would be John. And then we come to this strange passage of Scripture. What we didn't read is that right before the words Jesus spoke this morning, John sends his disciples to Jesus to ask him are you really he? Why? Why would a man who even in the womb recognized that Jesus was Lord, why would a man who spent his whole life preparing the way for Jesus question at the last moment whether he was the promised Messiah? Now we have to review John's circumstances. John was not an effective pastor. John would never have filled a church very well. You see, John just really didn't like telling people what they wanted to hear. John was far more fond of telling people what they were working very hard not to hear. That's the sort of thing a pastor does at his own risk, because inevitably you'll take someone off. And pastors learn early, if you tick someone off, SPRC knows what to do right away. John, you know, in some ways he was stupid. I mean, wow, what a faithful pastor. But he had to be crazy. I have no intention of going to the White House, let's see, to be politically correct, I'd better say, either under President Obama or under President Truman, and tell them what they're doing wrong. Number one, I'm way too old to climb fences. And number two, they wouldn't pay a bit of attention to me. But John the Baptist, he knew that there was a scum growing in the midst of Israel. And that scum was destroying the hearts of the people. And that scum was in the palace of the king. You see, Herod had married his, well, I'll tell you what, you don't want to do that family genealogy. He had married, I believe, his brother's wife, who was his part sister. Now, that's crazy. And this marriage was corrupting Israel. Have you ever seen how that can happen? You know, I worry the most about kids when marriages go in trouble, because the kids live with the consequences of that. Whether it's a lost family relationship, whether it's the fighting, whether it's uncomfortable things that happen, the kids bear that. And in Israel, it's what the king was doing that was corrupting the people. They figured if the king could get away with something like that, they could do anything they wanted. And it was showing in their lives. Now, I said John had to be somewhat crazy. And I'm not just talking about the fact that he wore camel hair inside out because it would itch more. Anybody here ever buy clothes because they'd itch more? I just don't understand that. It's not because he went around grabbing honey from wild bees. It's not even the fact that he ate grasshoppers, although I have to say at least he dipped them in the honey. It's the fact that he had crazy courage. He had the courage to go to the king and to proclaim in front of all the people that the king was living in sin, that his marriage was a sham, that he was destructive to Israel. Now let me tell you, if you ever go to the king or probably the president and do something like that, there are consequences. And John was bearing those consequences. He had been sentenced to death. Now we all know this story. It was going to take some doing because Herod was afraid of John. He knew he was a holy man, and he didn't know quite what to do with him. So he's leaving him in prison. Eventually, John will die because of that strange story in which Herod, who has such a weird marriage anyway, seems to have a bit of a crush on his daughter. And she is asked to dance for him. And she agrees if he'll give her anything she wants. And that will be the end of the Baptist, because she will dance and ask for John's head, and she will receive his head on a silver platter. John's in prison knowing what's going to happen. I don't know what must have been going through his mind, but just like so many of us, he suddenly had questions and doubts. You know, I find as I get older, I thought all the answers would be there. But I find the older I get, the more I have questions, the more I wonder how things fit in place. I think John, facing the end of his life, was wondering, have I wasted my whole life? I think John was wondering, why hasn't Jesus done something? Why aren't things changing? I spent my life witnessing to the truth. Has it had any impact? And so John, in a moment that must have been hard for him, sent his disciples to ask Jesus, did I mess up? Are you actually the Messiah? Everything's going wrong. Now I want us to hear this, because Jesus' response, to understand it, you have to go back to the last book of the Old Testament. It, by the way, is not the last book historically. It was the Christians for a very specific reason. In the third and fourth chapter, God talks about the days, well, about the days when things will change. And he says that in those days, chapter 4, in those days that he will bring back the prophet Elijah, the model of all prophets, the greatest prophet of ancient Israel, God says that when I am ready to send my messenger to come into the world again, I will send Elijah to lead the way. Now, what I love about what happens next, I don't know about you all, but I grew up in the 50s. They were very different times than now. Questioning my father was never a wise thing to do. Dad just didn't like to be questioned. He kind of figured he was right, and that ended things. I was a feisty thing, and I kind of figured that Dad was right far less than I was. And Dad really didn't like hearing that. And in those days, he had a very good way of showing that. So, you know, I kind of thought, John the Baptist knows the truth, and at the end of his life, he goes to God and he says, "Have I messed up my whole life? Are you really who you say you are? I mean, I'm having doubts here, and I'm thinking like Jesus is going to say, you know, I think it is time for your head to roll. I'm thinking Jesus is going to say, John, you're not the man I thought you were. But you know, what amazes me is God hears his doubts. God hears his questions. And God responds to him not only with love, but by lifting him up. Jesus says, "What did you go to the desert to see?" And he said, "I'll tell you what you went to see. A prophet." And he said, "I'll tell you something more. Not only is John a prophet, but he is Elijah. He is the fulfillment of Malachi. He is the promised one who will come and prepare the way for the work I'm about to do." I like that. I like that because it teaches me that God can handle my questions. It teaches me that when I have times of doubt, that when I am wavering in my faith, that not only can God handle that, but that he can love me in the midst of it. And not only love me, but lift me up and bless me. I think that's what I most love about Jesus. My wife and I have been so blessed to have our daughter Susan. But things have not always gone the way they're supposed to go. You know, when they're 10 and 11, I mean, the world revolved around me. There wasn't much I could say that she wouldn't agree with, even if she didn't. And then she got to be 12 to 13, and suddenly the world was shifting. By 14 and 15, yeah, the world had changed completely. You ladies have your own viewpoints in life, don't you? They don't necessarily have to agree with mom and dad's, right? Well, my daughter reached that stage late, but she sure is taking advantage of it. And it's stressful. It's hard. You know, she's living in ways that I just wish would change. But I love her. I care so deeply about her. And I will be there every step of the way. And God taught me that. He said, when you love somebody, they are going to have doubts. They're going to have questions. There are going to be hard times. But in the midst of those, you hold on to them. And you love them. And you care for them. Because that's what life is all about. I don't know what my thoughts were when I entered the ministry. You know, I guess a part of me said, gosh, I'm going to serve God. What a blessing. And it has been. But also right from the beginning, it's been painful. I hadn't yet been ordained, and I was doing part of my studies, and I was, quote unquote, a chaplain at Presbyterian St. Luke's Hospital in the children's ward. For the most part, it was a pretty good job. I got to go in and pray with people, and their kids went home, and everything was fine. Until one day I came in, and one of the nurses said, "We need you in this room." And I said, "What's going on?" And they said, "The baby just died." This baby was 3 days old. Those of you who have had children that haven't come to term know how painful that can be. Can you imagine what it is to hold a child, to love them, and then, while they're still tiny infants, lose them? And it was my job to go comfort the family. What can you possibly say to a family like that? And what compounded it is that in the midst of it, like John, I was going through my own questions and my own doubts. God, why'd you do this? You're all powerful. I mean, you could have snapped a finger and the baby would have lived. Why? Why is this happening? Have you ever had a moment like that in your life? A moment where things weren't going the right way and it seemed like everything you believed and everything you hoped for was dying? A few years later, I was in the ministry. This time it was a three-year-old. It was a really rough time because my daughter was three. And this little girl was diagnosed with brain cancer. We prayed for her and prayed for her and prayed for her. And she died. I don't ever in my ministry want to bury another three-year-old child. And again, the questions came up, why? Again, the hurt, the pain, the doubt. But in the midst of it, I found a God who loved me. And what I came to understand is that He wasn't going to run life my way. And that's what I was looking for. And he wasn't going to explain himself. That's what I was hoping for. But he wasn't going to let go of me either. He accepted my doubts, my questions, my pain, my hurt. And he held on to me tightly. And at one of the many moments in which I thought about leaving the ministry, he reinforced me, and he told me how valuable my ministry was. And he kept me going. There have been other times. A young man who was about you all's age, who came home drunk one night, and his family caught him, said they'd talk about it in the morning. And 30 seconds later, they heard a shotgun, and he was dead. They had so deep questions. They had such trouble holding on
And it raised a lot of my doubts and my questions again. What I want you to understand is this. As we uncover Jesus, we're going to come to the truth that faith is not easy. That all of us will go through times that try our patience. We'll go through times that cause us to doubt and question. And there'll be times of pain. But the one who loves you is greater than the pain. The one who loves you is greater than the doubts. The one who loves you is the one who's able to hear John the Baptist say, "Did I mess up? Are you him?" And can say, "I tell you, John the Baptist is the greatest born of women, that he is Elijah reborn." If you're here today and you've never doubted or questioned, you are blessed. But understand that those days will come. If you've gone through them, you know what I'm talking about. But what I want you to understand is that we serve a God who's greater than our doubts, who's greater than our questions, who's greater than our fears and our hesitations. A God who loves us and refuses to ever let go. Amen.